Hello, everybody, and welcome to Rise of the Podcast. I'm Jeremy.
I'm Kara.
I'm Brownie.
And boy, Episode 8, The Last Jedi, is a terrible movie.
And we know you agree with us because you clicked on this video.
That's right. But you're here. You agree.
Hashtag truth.
But actually, what we're doing is going back and, if you're not familiar with what we're doing, we're going back and rewatching all of the main series Star Wars films and generating two videos. One that explains why each of the films is great, and another, which is the one you're on now, which explains why each of them is terrible. So if you don't want to join in the Episode 8 hate, go ahead and click up in the corner here, and you can watch why Episode 8 is a terrific, great, phenomenal, and all-around fantastic movie. But if you're like the rest of the universe, and you just want to heap on the hate on Episode 8, you've come to the right place.
Hate.
So, I haven't seen a movie this bad since The Phantom Menace.
Oh!
Starting off strong. We're just going to just be throwing knives at this movie. No, go watch the other one. We do like the movie, but there's ways that it could have been a lot better. Truly, yes. Been a lot better.
As with any movie in the entire world.
Yes, especially this one.
My overall arc, which is a little bit off the list, is just, I feel like there was a direction the trilogy was going to go,
mm-hmm.
and then this movie got steered in a different direction, and then it's going to get re-diverted back.
Well, that's what you get, having one director, hand it off to another director, and then hand it back to the original director.
Well,
you know?
4, 5, and 6 is George Lucas, Irvin Kershner, I don't know who directed 6, but yeah. It wasn't either of them.
It did switch, but it's just, okay. All right, let's get it.
I think the problem was it switched, but they didn't have any plan of what they were going to do. So they're
right.
Just like,
right.
Go ahead, Rian Johnson. And yes. He's like, okay.
Well, that's just it. And like, A New Hope ended. It's a standalone movie.
Yep.
Whereas the Force Awakens is kind of a continue.
Yeah, like literally every film except for the original Star Wars, mm-hmm. you know there's something else coming. Except for maybe Episode 9, maybe they will just slam the doors shut mm-hmm. and just call this done and just only do stories from here on out.
They're going to tug on our heartstrings at the end and do flashbacks of the old movies.
And
there's not going to be a dry eye in the house.
I think Kylo Ren's helmet is a symbolism for like the directors not getting along for whatever reason. Cause
to the dark side.
It's in the first movie, and then in the second one, Snoke's like, take off that stupid helmet, and then he smashes it to pieces, and in the third movie, he's gluing it back together.
Yeah, you see it with his little hot glue gun.
I'm here, everybody.
Did I miss that? Was that in the trailer?
It's in the trailer. Oh, yeah, he's welding it back together. Yeah.
That's hilarious.
He's not gluing it back together.
So he's going to have it on again.
There's not enough glitter to hold it all together.
Oh, and he uses red. Hold it all together.
Oh, of course.
Yeah, it's on the minifig.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, it's
on the minifig. Oh, that's funny.
So anyways, all right.
Diving in.
We get these awesome scenes, which we talk about in the other video. But then we get these resistance bombers, which you get all these ships in Star Wars you got A-Wings that are fast, you got Y-Wings, which are even still fast enough to make a trench run or make a shot at.
X-Wings are fast. I mean,
TIE Fighters are crazy ass.
Star Destroyers are fast.
Yeah.
Seriously, Star Destroyers apparently move faster than B-Wings.
Yep.
Bombers, whatever.
Well, they were chasing down the Millennium Falcon. Millennium Falcon's pretty quick.
Yeah.
And he had to do that sort of slide to the left move to get away from them.
Slide to the left.
But we get this bombing scene where I just hate when things aren't plausible, and I know that it's Star Wars is not real, but
they have an internal like reality.
Yes.
That we've come to agree the way things basically work.
Mm-hmm.
13 ships and one made it on target.
And they moved it like a mile an hour.
A mile an hour.
And Hux is screaming at them, attack that bomber! It's like, you've got all of these TIE fighters and not a single one can hit this massive bomber that's coming toward you?
That's my beef with the 13. You've got 12 that are taken out immediately. Right. It's like Game of Thrones. So in Game of Thrones, there's a dragon and there's multiple dragons and they all take out the dragon. And then in this, it's the same. It's like the exact same thing. And then the one dragon makes it through 30 ballistas and then wipes the entire city.
Yeah.
And so in this, you've got, they immediately kill 12 bombers. Now, if they had been like one and then like two and then like they were getting closer and it was just even, it would have made more sense. But 12 and then one lone bomber is like,
whoa. Well, so, and then just speaking of the number 13 too, it's just like, how is this the entire resistance fleet has only 13 bombers?
Right.
And Leia was mad about it. Like, oh, we had suffered a huge loss. Now we lost. Now we don't have any more bombers. It's like, where do you get your bombers from? You need a bomber guy.
Yeah. Well, you got the dude that they stole the ship from later.
The coder breaker. But the whole thing, like the pilot's dead, then the whole gravity, the way the bombs fall out.
Die.
Yeah, it's like, clearly the bombers are made out of papier-mâché because they get touched by one laser and then they explode.
Yes.
Right,
the pilot died of probably trying to understand the situation.
Truth. But then, what bugs me is they're in space. There's no gravity in space. Now, does a Star Destroyer make its own gravity? Is it that big that it does that?
Yeah, I mean, so technically gravity, if it has mass, whatever. But I agree with, the way that it works, it feels like Earth-level gravity.
Right. And so, they go and they drop these bombs, and they immediately, boom, right down into the dreadnought.
Even kicking the ladder to get the remote control to fall down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That remote control wouldn't have fallen like that. It would have, you know.
And then even if there's artificial gravity on the ship that would cause that, the artificial gravity wouldn't extend down to have the bombs fall down.
Opening up the bay door, that would have completely negated any artificial gravity.
Yeah. It would have created a vacuum.
Yeah. Well, they have all the landing docks have those magnetic shield things or whatever. Yeah, but even if they had that, they wouldn't be able to drop the bomb through it.
Exactly. So
the bombers have a lot of problems with
them. Yes, they do.
To me, it would have made more sense to have a big bomb that was just jets it in or whatever.
Yeah, not even drop it, but just almost missile it down into it.
Yeah, it actually has some sort of thrust or something. Yeah.
Right, not just, we're just going to drop all these guys and hope there's some sort of gravity field that's going to pull it down to the dreadnought.
Just this suspension of disbelief is immediately broken, and it just feels weird and wrong and... Don't watch that scene.
And we kind of touched on this next point a little bit, but because there's only 13 bombers, there's only a few fighters. The scale of the ships, because the dreadnought's huge, Snoke's ship's even bigger.
Right.
So they've got way more, way bigger ships. The resistance doesn't feel like there's enough people to even form a resistance.
That is my exact point.
Yep.
How are they, and why does the First Order care at this point? What are they going to do?
Right. Honestly, it's like a fly. You know, that's basically what the Resistance is compared to the First Order.
Yeah.
The new trailer, I hate to use this as an example, but you see the shot of the Millennium Falcon and then all of the ships behind it. That's what I want the Resistance to have and see.
You're coming together.
Give us that portrayal.
I mean, at the end of The Last Jedi, they did say they had allies elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. But no one's coming.
But nobody came.
But yeah, and then so the thing is, why would they show up later then? It's like, if they just saw the Resistance get their butts kicked, they're like, I'm going to join that team.
Seriously, I mean, I'd be like, there's about 10 of you, so no.
Yeah, there's literally, I would bet that there's more people on one of those new AT-ATs than there was in the entire
I know. I know, the Gorilla Walkers.
Yeah, they look cool.
They do.
But yeah, everything is scaled.
Yes,
miniaturized Death Star to blow through the doors and stuff like that. It's like, how can they have all of this stuff and not have already won?
Yeah, well, that's just it. And then they have all this stuff, but the Resistance has nothing of its own.
Right.
Like in A New Hope, it felt plausible that there was like these band of fighters were throughout all the galaxy and the rebellion was a real threat to the Empire.
Mm-hmm.
But in this, it just feels like we only see one little pocket of Resistance, or they even narrate the story that way. And the First Order scale is just way too massive.
Yeah, like, I get they if they wanted to give a sense of hopelessness, that's fine. But they just pushed it so far, it's just, like, cartoonish. It's like like if the United States was going after Jeremy.
Yes.
It's like, we gotta get Jeremy. He's a threat to the entire United States.
I started the Resistance.
And they send, like, the entire Air Force and most of the Navy and just, like, to go down the street to, like, get you.
I look out my window and two F-16 just pop off. Yeah. This guy. Like they're coming for me.
Papa.
And you're like, I've only got a half tank of gas.
Yeah, exactly. I'm going to turn my car into hyperdrive.
So,
right.
Another thing, so like the whole plot of the movie is a chase movie, right?
Yes. Yeah. Which is...
One of the biggest problems that we all had with this is the thing that where they're describing the act of tracking.
So the First Order is only tracking us from one destroyer, the lead one.
So we blow that one up.
I like where your head's at, but no, they'd only start tracking us from another destroyer.
But if we
sneak on board the lead destroyer and disable the tracker without them realizing...
They won't realize it's off for one system cycle. About 6 minutes.
Yes.
So A, the fact that you can track through hyperspace, I think, like, whatever, fine.
Mm-hmm.
But when they're like... It can only be on the... It's only the lead ship, and it's only ever the lead ship. It's like, why would... This, I think, ties into this larger point of, like, the Empire or the First Order. It's like, they don't want to waste resources or something. It's like, we're not going to shoot the escape pod. We're not going to shoot the capital ship pointing at us. We're not going to bother having all of our massive ships that obviously have tracking capabilities bother tracking. If it's that important, you would have all of them doing it.
Right. In case one happens to go down.
Yep.
You know? That does bug me.
Yeah.
Because, like, who's to say then if the lead ship goes down, who's to say which Star Destroyer is the next lead ship?
Yeah. It's like when you play volleyball and two people go, got it.
Yep.
And then they bump into each other and the Star Destroyers do that.
And, yeah, why can't all of them be active tracking at one time? Because there's going to be Imperial codes.
Yeah.
And then there's going to be, like, Resistance codes. So they're not going to cross and be like, oh, you know, we're tracking ourselves accidentally. It's
you would think that because the way that, like, tracking stuff works here is, like, the more points, like, of GPS.
Yep.
The more satellites you have, the more accurate the track is.
Right.
So you'd think the more people you have tracking it, the more accurate the track would be.
Right. Because they can triangulate it off of the other Star Destroyer's positions to the distance from that one to the other Star Destroyer's.
So, it's like, if you have a known position and speed, and then if all of them have known positions and speed, and you're getting feedback from each one with their track, you can get a very, very, very precise measurement. I know we're, like, really drilling down into this, but it's like, it's technology that we have on Earth that works in a very certain way, and it's like, why would they make it different and worse?
Right.
In a future, granted, it's in the past, a long time ago, whatever, but
they're way beyond us.
Technology. It blows the mind.
Well, then my other thing I don't like about it either is just the simple fact that it's always been a cool mechanic of them people being able to escape using hyperspace. It's like...
Yeah, that's like in episode 5, like the Millennium Falcon needed to get into hyperspace to get away the whole time, and then it wouldn't work, and then they put a tracker on it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So once it comes out of hyperspace,
they know where it is.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fine. I buy that.
I love it. Because then that means it's something that... is the main characters shouldn't have let a tracker be on their ship, or it just it falls onto the character, but it just the whole you can just track it. It removes a mechanic from Star Wars that's not fun.
Yeah, it makes it too easy for the bad guys to just show up and wipe you out.
Right.
And we had talked about this. So what we would have changed is like what would have been better in our opinion is if there was a mole on the ship, and the reason they couldn't go is because they would just give their position away again. And then the whole thing with Holdo not telling everybody the plan because
they didn't
want the mole to know the plan. All of the things.
Yep.
And then you don't need to send people off to Canto Bight, which we'll get to in a minute.
We'll get to
it. It solves all of these problems just by making it somebody inside. And then like you can have people accusing Finn because he's a former...
First Order?
Yeah, he was former First Order.
Who's trying to escape.
There's all of these things. Because he would still want to try and get to Rey.
Right.
You know, so like that whole part could still stay intact.
Right.
And they're just, it seems like so obvious. Granted, hindsight being 2020, but it seems like such an obvious change from this completely ludicrous lack of technology or over technology.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
To just have it be there's a betrayer in their midst. But then the opening crawl.
Right. That would have been so much better.
It's harder to scramble or fake or spoof the act of tracking, but it's easier to crack a slit in the ship's defense, go to a different planet, come back, sneak onto the ship, get to a specific room and disable it rather than
And please tell me how they would have time to do that with the limited fuel that they had.
Yeah, we're talking about space gas and how fast they're burning through it.
And
how much faster is light speed than the speed that they're going then?
You know? Right. Like, exactly. So that it makes more sense for them to just chug. And the ship can do hyperspace, but then there's no speed between there. Do they can? Because the ship's outrunning the First Order ship, and they're like, they'll run out of gas eventually.
Yeah.
It's like they can't reel in that distance. They can't. Yeah. What if they hyperspaced in front of it and then came at it, you know?
Well, yeah, exactly. It's like you got to spend space gas to turn around.
But the First Order can't shoot that, skate pod. So
you can tell they're moving at a constant speed, so you just do your light speed calculation to hop just ahead of them.
Yeah.
And then they're sunk. There's no way they know where they're
going. Yeah.
Well, and the First Order ships are so big that even if they crashed into the First Order ship, no damage.
Yeah, no, for real.
And it'd be in the
Then Hux could have had an awesome moment where he's like, Poe Dameron, I'm on the line for you.
Right?
I'll wait.
Bring it back around.
Yeah. It'd be so funny.
Oh.
Give Hux a moment for once. But
poor Hux. He does get a lot of grief.
It's a little teeny.
I like his character a lot.
I do too.
A lot of people do.
But there's this is a little moment. Just, again, remember watching the movie and when Kylo Ren is like, shoots the deck and Admiral Akbar gets sucked out and Leia gets sucked out.
He doesn't shoot them, the other TIE fighters do.
Yeah, he was going to and he pulls out because he's having his...
He can sense his mom on there. And there's like that conflict connection with your mom, you know?
He killed his dad.
Okay, moms are always softer though and moms are always more...
No one ever says thanks, Dad, after they win the Super Bowl.
Right, exactly.
Thanks, Mom.
Yep,
that's
always
it.
What it is.
So he doesn't shoot his mom. The TIE fighters blow up, and but Leia is out in space and
for an awkwardly long time.
And we don't know that she was maybe going to be the last Jedi. There's internet, Jar Jar's Sith Lord. But anyways, so we see her use the Force, and again, it's like 0 to 60 in the Force. She uses the Force to pull herself back in.
Right.
Again, you could have just portrayed a moment where she almost died without ruining the suspension of disbelief inside the universe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she could use the Force when the thing gets shot and pull herself just to the bulkhead door.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It's the same exact thing, but she doesn't have to sit out in space for an awkward amount of time.
Right.
I mean, have you guys seen, you've seen Love, Death, Robots? Have you seen that episode where the girl has to, take off her glove?
Oh, and then the equal,
breaks off her arm.
She wouldn't even have to use the Force.
Yeah.
They would have just had an auto breather thing that came up, Star-Lord's helmet.
She obviously is Force sensitive because she's Luke's sister.
Right.
Right.
Or whatever, and he could have taught her something. Is that, that's all, the fact that she uses the Force is not the thing that I question. The fact that and I don't even know how long it takes, in movie time.
Right.
But it seems like it's a foregone conclusion that anybody that sat out there that long should be dead at this point.
Right.
Right.
And it's
she should have had a rebreather.
Yeah.
And why didn't she grab Akbar on the way? Dang it.
Poor Akbar.
Added to the list of characters you feel deserved a better death.
Yep. Boba Fett, Admiral Akbar.
Yep.
Just saying.
Gotta add Admiral Akbar to my shirt now.
Oh, well, then the Kit Fisto and whoever in episode 3.
Okay, all the Jedi. Plo Koon.
So it's like, everybody that dies, Kara thinks they should have died better.
Watch Clone Wars and you'll understand.
Now, this next one, we're all very passionate about.
Oh, my goodness. So about 50% of the movie takes place here.
Just cut it out.
Just boop,
the simple
gone.
Solution to this is just remove Canto Bite from 100%. The story.
Look, this whole place is beautiful. I mean, come on. Why'd you hate it so much?
Look closer.
My sister and I grew up in a poor mining system. The First Order stripped our ore to finance their military.
It doesn't add to the movie at all.
It feels like a waste of time.
Well, no, and even the developing relationship sort of between Rose and Finn could have just as easily taken place on the ship.
Yeah. Right. Like, everybody's accusing him of being the mole, but yeah. Rose is the only one who... Rose and Finn are the only ones who believe that he's not a mole.
Right.
Yeah. You know?
They still could have worked with Poe to try to come up with a plan.
And, like, she uses her knowledge of, like, the back quarters of the ship to, like, hide him away or something, you know? Like, you'd have all this internal action. So, like, you have this big-scale chase and the small-scale chase happening at the same time.
Right.
Yeah.
That could be a way cooler movie.
Right.
Seriously, guys, we should have written this movie. Dang it!
Hey, Filoni, call me. I'll help you out. Help you write The Mandalorian.
I'll be in it.
I'll sit behind the camera and watch. And make fun of them as they do it.
That's right. So,
But yeah, there's literally nothing. Like, the whole reason they go there gets, you see the guy they're supposed to get, they get somebody else. Who ends up screwing them over in the end. That doesn't even matter at the end because the plan wasn't the plan anyway. They're going to smash the ship into the ship.
Right.
And it's like everything that happened in the movie seemed like a pointless waste of time.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Which is like really unfortunate because there's some great moments in the movie, but it's like it's such a large proportion of the film.
Red Claw Bloom.
The Master Codebreaker.
Yep, those are the shuttle parkers.
You two are under arrest for parking violation 27B.
They get arrested for a parking ticket.
The dumbest thing ever.
So here's the thing.
Not even defined, but they get thrown in jail.
Yeah.
For a parking ticket.
Here's the list of things that should not be in Star Wars movies. Space taxes. Space gas. Space parking tickets. These are things that exist in real life that cause people problems. We don't need that in Star Wars.
I don't want that extra stress in movies I love.
You know, it's like, oh, they didn't parallel park properly. It's like,
oh, dad. Their wheels were more than 12 inches from the curb.
Is your space registration paid on your car?
Oh my God. Man. Your tabs are expired.
Yeah, your space brake light is out. I got to bring you in.
That's what it feels like.
It's just absurd.
How obsessed the guy is with busting him, too. That alien, he's like, oh, there they are. You know, it's like, leave him alone.
I told them that wasn't public parking.
Yeah, just like, what is this, like, obviously, if he's there, he either works for the place and has a miserable life, or he's a super rich dude. Either way, why would he care? Yeah, why would he care?
Right, I know, like.
Yeah, you're sweet, you just got a free ship, bro.
Yeah, no, yeah, just tow it away. Free spaceship.
Yep. And then they're running towards their ship and they blow it up.
Yeah.
Because you got a parking ticket. We're gonna blow up the ship.
Man, could you imagine in Duluth if you got just blow your car up if you don't feed the meter?
Yeah. Do you know how many people would have their cars blown up outside my work? So there's this salty lady who lives in the apartments across from where I work, and if you're parked incorrectly, she'll call and they will come and ticket every single car on that row.
I bet she's from Canto Bight.
She is. She is from Canto Bight.
They're parked all wrong.
She's out there putting C4 on the car.
Oh,
and she's
sitting
there, and blows up all the cars.
So yeah, just like there's it adds nothing. The only redeeming sort of thing, the kid that uses the force of the broom at the very end.
Yeah,
right? Like you get introduced to him on there, and then you see it's like, oh, there's more hope in the universe or whatever. And that whole moment, you literally could have just cut away to literally anywhere in the galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
It could have been a different planet that sees like the space chase happening or whatever. It doesn't matter what it was. If Canto Bight solely existed for that one moment, we could do without it.
Yep.
Right. Yep. Totally
agree. Oh, boy. Yep, so Canto Bight thumbs down.
Big thumbs down.
So, and then we touched on the Codebreaker already. So then the last thing that we're going to talk about is the character of Snoke.
Oh, Snoke, not Smoke.
Okay. Speaking of that, though, when we were at Celebration, there was a guy dressed as Snoke, and he was carrying around a sign that says...
No Snoking.
Oh. Ooh.
It was pretty funny. It was like the classic red circle with the line through it. It was pretty funny. And a good snow costume,
actually. It was really good.
He had, like, the prosthetic, like, whatever made him
gross
look old.
Skin.
Yeah,
oh,
cool. It looked really cool.
I have a picture right
but,
here.
Yeah.
No. I put my foot down, but not actually because it makes too much noise.
Yep, you're making eight Chris angry.
But Snoke, right?
Yep.
It worked for Palpatine. It doesn't work for Snoke.
Right.
Well, they took all the, like, they took three movies, basically, to get to Palpatine.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know, it's like, he's implied in the first one, you see a hologram of him in the second one, he actually, you get to see him in the third one.
Right.
And then, he was just, like, manipulating all the stuff behind the scenes. What does Snoke actually do? He doesn't do anything. He didn't dissolve the Senate. He wasn't the, like, so maybe he converted Kylo Ren, but there's not really an explanation.
Then you can just reference him. You don't need to make him this big character.
And he basically does nothing except for pit Hux and Kylo Ren against each other.
Yeah,
right.
Pointlessly. Like, if you're running an organization, you don't want your next two managers below you to be just, like, trying to ruin the other person's plans.
Right.
It's just, like, bad management technique. And then he suffers from the same Sith overconfidence that everybody has. He gets cut in half by Kylo Ren. It's like... nothing and died like a chump.
Yes.
Right.
And it's just like...
Now, I will say, the look of surprise on his face when he dies is a little bit on the satisfying side.
Yeah. But, or the scene, though, when they show his body falling.
Yeah, like, he's like...
It is really funny. But then what was his plan there? He's going to turn Rey and then what? Give up on Kylo Ren?
Yeah.
Kylo Ren brought her in.
What Palpatine was going to do with Vader.
Yeah, but at least Vader was old and, you know, like, he could get fresh Luke.
He's more machine now than man.
Okay, he recognized there was weakness in Kylo Ren.
And it seemed like Palpatine was fine with Luke killing him and just joining Darth Vader, too.
Yeah.
So it's like, I don't know if that makes sense or not, but it's like...
No.
Yeah, true.
Because he was like, strike me down, and you'll blah, blah, blah. And like, so maybe...
He knew Vader was going
to
stop
Or maybe he does know the secret of coming back to life or whatever, and he's like...
We'll find out.
Yeah, it's like, it's the Sith version of the Force Ghost. He's like, strike me down, and I'll grow more powerful, and you'll also be on the dark side. Yay!
Yeah. So, yeah, it just, with Snoke, boo.
They did nothing with the character. They set him up badly, they used him badly, and he died badly.
Yep.
You know, it's like, you talk about characters that deserved a better death. If he was a better character, he would deserve a better death.
Right, if he was a better baddie.
But he
Palpatine
died,
got a sick death.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah, he got hucked into an energy chamber or something. I don't even know what that was. Why is that elevator? Why is that shaft there?
Every single ship has a shaft like that. I'm telling you. Bespin had one. The Death Star has one. Star Destroyers, I feel, have them.
Star Killer Base had one. That's where Han fell down.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what's with all these crazy high places with limited hand railing?
Even Tatooine had one.
Yeah, the Sarlacc pit.
Space OSHA hasn't been there to
inspect. My goodness. That's the Star Wars movie we all need, is with space safety administration.
Can you imagine if somebody did, not a parody, but Matt the janitor.
Oh, yeah.
Like that type of thing, but going around and inspecting all of these high places with no railings.
Like, so many credits worth of fines. All right. Well, anyway, that's as good a place as any to stop for this one, I think. So those are the reasons why we think that Episode 8 is a terrible movie. Again, if you want to join in and add your own comments, obviously we didn't get to everything, but I think we did a pretty representative job of the things that made it a bad movie. But toss that down in the comment section below if you want to refute any of our points. We can have a conversation down there as well. Like this video, comment, or subscribe if you haven't already. Ring the notification bell if you want to be notified of everything that we upload. It means a lot to us. It shows that you're on board with what you're doing and you want to see what we're doing and you want to see more. And of course,
may the Force be with you.